Well, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to Standards Australia here in Bridge Street, Sydney. For those of you who've been able to join us and to all of you online, a very good afternoon, good evening and good morning to you all. My name's Adam Stingemore. I'm the General Manager of Engagement and Communications with Standards Australia. And as we start this afternoon, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we meet here in Sydney, the Eora people of the Gadigal Nation, and pay respects to elders past, present and emerging. This is a very, very important conversation for us this afternoon that we're starting on digital engineering. A term that for all of the people in the room here today probably means something a little bit different. But if I could start with my own personal reflections, having started my professional career as a construction litigator more than 20 years ago, the construction sector has an opportunity ahead of it to build on a lot of the work that many of you are doing, many of you are leading, and that many of you are deeply, deeply involved in today. But in order to do that, we're probably going to have to change the way that we've been doing some things for not just 20 years, but 200 years. I could be entirely wrong. You might all say, you know what, Adam, there's nothing to change, everything's fine, nothing to see here. We have a slightly different view. And to start this conversation here this afternoon, I'm very pleased to have Simon Vox with us. Simon, a leader described by some, a disruptor described by others, and presently CEO of Dios Digital. Simon, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Adam. It's great to be here, and it's great to see so many people have actually shown up to attend and talk about digital engineering today, both here in present and also online. So welcome to you all.
Simon, tell me about your experience in the construction sector.
So I am a civil engineer by background, chartered civil engineer with ICE. I started my career about 20 years ago, and if I reflect back, first working as a structural engineer on day one, I was introduced to the red pencil, the blue pencil, tracing paper, so butter paper and a drawing board, and I was told how to trace architectural drawings and, you know, work out loads and so forth. You know, it's kind of surprised me, I think, just in the year 2001 to actually be working that way, but that was, you know, still the way some people worked. And over the years, I moved from designing bridges to managing designs to working in railways, and then around 2007 joined Transport for New South Wales, and for 14 years I was working inside government to drive or manage projects, but also then start to drive change around digital engineering. So had a bit of an arc from starting very much with the analog way of working to something that was very much digital by the end.
And just reflecting back on the drafting table and the blue and red pencil, What's changed between that sort of first start in your career and where we are today?
Less pencils. I'd say, like, you know, what's really changed is there's a lot more appetite for working online. You know, we've, over the 20-year period, if we take a step back and not just look at our industry, just look at society. Society's changed so much. And, you know, consumer tech is everywhere. Like, you know, we don't even talk about smartphones anymore. It's just phones. Technology is ubiquitous. The appetite for using data, for managing data, for accessing data and analytics and everything that it entails is significant. And so that's what's happening in the world around us. In our sector, there are things happening. Like, there's been the introduction in the last maybe 10 years or so, things like BIM have really taken off. But they, you know, have moved us some part of the way. But I'd say that our industry still has a lot of challenges, still has issues with project overruns, with productivity, You could go as far as to say diversity and other things like that as well. So there's a lot more that could be done in our sector to try to make it a lot more digital than potentially where we are right now.
And just sort of drilling in a little bit on the sort of smartphone piece, how does a smartphone have anything to do with engineering infrastructure projects? Talk to me about that.
Okay, that's a good question. I'll start a bit abstract and we'll work our way in. A thing that I read late last year, which sort of was a real light bulb moment for me, I started getting into reading textbooks about databases. And in one textbook, there's this image, and it was the ubiquitous nature of, or the pervasive nature of databases. But the image was called A Day in Susan's Life. And if you Google it, just go into Google Images, A Day in Susan's Life, maybe chuck database on the end. And it just showed at five phases throughout the day the kind of things that Susan's up to. So when she first gets up, she goes on her social media, like Facebook, Twitter, whatever, and she's interacting with databases, but she just doesn't see it. At lunchtime, she goes to the shops, she goes to the chemist. The chemist is using databases to manage inventory. After work, she goes to the supermarket. When she gets home, she does online shopping. She books a holiday later on. And at every stage, she's interacting with databases. And it got me thinking more and more around just how pervasive databases are these days. And if you think about your mobile phone, everything that you're doing on your mobile phone is interacting with a database. It's just you just don't see it. It's like there's the iceberg. What you see above is the app, and that's the presentation layer. But underneath all of that, behind every app that you use virtually is a database. And those databases all have design, which is a data model. And that is the starting point of understanding what data architecture is like and what true digital transformation is all about. So every other sector is moving in this space, building up capabilities with databases, except for ours. And so that's the starting point of where we want to have this new conversation around what digital engineering could really mean for our sector.
Okay. So just want to move on to BIM, Building Information Modeling. There's a lot of data associated with all the work that's going on in BIM, and that's continuing to iterate and move. How is this conversation different from the evolution of BIM?
Good question. Make me think. So with BIM, a bit like with digital engineering, if you got everybody around the room say, hey, what's BIM, you are going to get a whole cross-section of definitions. But maybe if we just talk about the heritage of where BIM's come from and how it's evolved. It really started from CAD. It was all about the evolution from 2D drawings to 3D models for visualization. Then the next evolution was packing metadata inside that 3D model. So let's call it a smart 3D model as such. Now, with the advent of UK standards becoming ISO standards, the BIM approach has really taken off, and it did show a real difference between the previous way of working with two-dimensional drawings to now having 3D models that you can interact with. But where I'd say there's a limitation of BIM is that BIM requires that you manage metadata inside a 3D model. And I'd sort of put out the concept that maybe 3D models aren't the best vehicle for managing metadata. Every other sector just uses databases. Every other sector has built up expertise in this space from data governance, data management, data analytics and business intelligence. But if we continue to insist on using BIM as a solution, being a metadata stored inside a 3D model, then we're locking away the capability of accessing metadata on a broad scale. So I think BIM's come a long way. It's been instrumental in driving a lot of change, but I think it's also worth examining what every other sector is doing and whether or not there's further things that we can explore and capitalize on.
Excellent. So sort of going backwards from there, we've got the BIM 3D model that sort of operates down here. What operates upstream of that in a digital engineering environment?
It's a bit, it feels a bit like heresy to sort of suggest that BIM wouldn't be the center of your project, which is, I guess, the concept that when I first started on the journey, that's what I would have believed is the way forward. But what I'd say is that instead of BIM being the core, I'd say it's a component. So what's at the center? Structured data, people talk about that a lot, but structured data, in my view, should be a database. That's how you manage metadata. That's how every other sector does it. So when we talk about structured data, we should really be reframing that to a common data model. A common data model that is used to design the way your databases work, so we can manage metadata. So BIM could just be one component out of every other deliverable that you manage on the projects, which so GIS, drawings, requirements, time, cost, risk, all these other components, all these other information deliverables using common metadata, or we'll call that a common data model. And so BIM is one very instrumental deliverable, but it's not the center. At the center is a database that manages metadata and works with many other deliverables, with BIM and many others.
And what does that allow us to do differently? How would that change things if we were to sort of start thinking about a common data model that sits above engineering projects?
This is foundational, if I sort of describe it like that. The real benefit is once you start talking about data in this sort of level, then you can start thinking around data analytics. You can start thinking around business intelligence, not just for a single organization, but for a sector. Or, there's a lot of talk these days about the digital thread or the golden thread of data. Now, this is not just a file management approach of managing files and then trying to make do. We want to try to automate processes as much as possible. Now, automation requires databases to actually inform the automation. Sorry, I got to talk in front of the mic a bit more. Is that? Yeah, sorry. So the other benefit, so we have the digital thread. We want to be able to line up different life cycle stages from concept design, detail design, construction, operate, maintain. We don't want to have disconnected life cycle processes. We want to build up from the entire life cycle, so we have that efficiency and we can start driving automation. The other benefits is that there's a lot of talk about, say, digital twins, and digital twins not just for projects but for organizations or for jurisdictions. So New South Wales has got the New South Wales Spatial Digital Twin. Victoria's got Digital Twin Victoria. There are national digital twin programs happening around the world. What they really predicate on is all organizations setting up metadata in a consistent way. So it means that multiple organizations can all talk and share and exchange, and you can get analytics, you can have dashboarding that sits above all of that, which if we insist on managing data sets with metadata squirreled away that can't be accessed unless you're using specialist software, or if we're managing data just as files, we're never going to get there. We're not going to be able to achieve these smarter objectives, smart cities, smart infrastructure, if we still if we don't have that sort of foundational data model set up first of all. And if I extend that a bit further, because I think where this goes to is smart cities. I think that's, if you imagine a pyramid, that's at the pinnacle. And most governments want to set up smart cities. What we don't want is smart shanty towns. We don't want to have, disconnected little pockets of data that there are smart bits, but then there's a wasteland in between. If we want to have this orchestrated, we've got to think around the architecture, the master planning for how these smart cities will work on a digital level. And that's where, full circle, that's where this data model really comes in.
Excellent. When we started, well, as the start of this conversation, we've put out a paper on digital engineering, Simon, that you worked very closely with us to develop. And in it, we talk about the concepts of the built environment and the digital environment coming together.
Hmm.
And one of your points in the paper is that, I want to get this right, engineering is from Mars and digital is from Venus. What the hell does that mean, Simon?
I probably had a bit too much caffeine when I wrote that, but it made sense at the time. No, what I was trying to get to there is, I think the book came out 80s or 90s, it's written in the paper. It was an international bestseller. And it's just all about different parties communicate and handle pressure in different ways. Essentially, different parties think differently, and you need to understand how other people think to be able to communicate and get along, like just avoid conflict. And I was using that as a way of describing how The way the digital world tends to operate, the way they think around data, is very different to the current state of the way our sector mostly thinks around data. And I think for us to be able to engage in a digital, to start becoming more digital the way every other sector is doing it, we need to start understanding what are their artifacts, what are their ceremonies, what are the ways that the way that they work, so we can start doing that too. And so instead of, you know, this concept of different worlds, how do we bring these two worlds together? And that's, you know, if we are able to, you know, speak openly and start to challenge existing ideas, then maybe we can start to learn from what they're doing. We can start picking up that too.
Okay. So two more questions for me, and then we're going to open up to a sort of broader panel discussion, yep. Simon. The last 18 months, 2 years in Australia, there's been an emerging conversation about embodied carbon and embodied energy within buildings and infrastructure, and how we might, economy-wide, do better at sort of trying to count that, capture that, manage that through the life cycle of a facility.
Yep.
I have two questions that hang off that. First of all, can we do that today? And then second of all, would digital engineering help us do that better?
All right, yeah. Look, first one, can we do it today? We could. But yeah, we could do a lot better. So how would it be done today? I'd say that the counting carbon is very similar to other sort of activities like cost estimation, where organizations have their own IP, they have their own ways of doing it, but it would never be done automatically. So everything can be done manually, but it's just inefficient. So you could have, a bit like in cost estimation, we'd have a whole bunch of cost estimators working to try to append cost to deliverables, to items, to assets, to activities. You could do the same thing with carbon. But the better way of doing it is to, once again, if you have a data model where you say, right, every time this material comes up, this is how much carbon is produced per ton of this material. And that's just a property then of different types of assets. So if you start thinking around it just being another entity or another attribute in your database, with every other entity and attribute, and all the relationships are already pre-designed because you've thought about the data architecture well before you ever thought about counting carbon on a specific project. So when you start, when you then just start building up catalogs, libraries of, you know, carbon, or the amount of carbon on different types of assets and so forth. So when it goes and gets to the projects, you want to do carbon, embodied carbon calculation, that is automated as much as possible. And so that's a difference from current state to future state.
Excellent. So last question from me before we open up to the panel discussion. Today we're starting this conversation in Australia about digital engineering. Where would you like us to get to over the next few months as this conversation evolves? Is there something that we're sort of tangibly trying to achieve? Is there a change that we're looking for? Is there a community we're looking to build? What is it that, you know, in 2 or 3 months' time, we can say, you know what, we've done well from starting this conversation today?
Apart from me still having a job. I'd say the what we want to do is, I think with sort of organisational change, and I can speak from experience, I've sort of worked in organisational change and when I was at transport, you can either go top down or you can go bottom up. So the bottom up is sort of pilot projects, case studies, testing things, let's just do stuff. But that can only get you so far sometimes. So maybe a top-down might be something you want to consider. Top-down, you start with a vision. What's the flag on a hill, the lighthouse, the sort of thing that everyone goes, all right, we agree with that. Once you have a common agreement, you can then set a culture around it. This is what we're all working towards. And that's something that we're kind of missing, I think. So if we can first start getting some agreement on what our collective vision is, something short, snappy, right, we're going to try to achieve or send industry in this new direction. From that, we can then start thinking around roadmap, we can think around participants. But I liken it a bit like when, maybe in the last 20 years, how safety really changed in the construction sector. where one of the first things that happened was the industry created, excuse the pun, but they created a safe space in industry to be able to go, we need to talk about this. We need to talk about safety, and we don't want to have defensive attitudes. We don't want to have people saying mission accomplished, nothing to see here. We want to have a serious conversation around what we should be changing. And that set industry in a new direction where safety isn't something anyone can question now. And I think for us, if we can start to create a safe space within our sector to be able to start questioning, challenging, learning and growing, and start thinking around a new vision for what our sector could be, and we could start doing that in the next few months, I think that would be signs that we're going in the right direction.
Excellent. And for us at Standards Australia, Simon, we're very happy to host that conversation over the next few months to see where we get to. We want all of you to come on this journey with us. It's not an exclusive conversation in any way, and it's the people around us today and others who will be able to help us move. So I want to shift gears a little bit and welcome Dr. James Glastonbury, the Executive General Manager of Engineering Technology and Innovation with McConnell Dow, to join us, and Dr. Ian Opperman, the New South Wales Government Chief Data Scientist, Industry Professor at UTS, and Director of Standards Australia. Good afternoon, James and Ian.
Great to be here.
Thanks, Adam. Good to be here.
James, you've heard us sort of start this conversation off this afternoon, but for you in your role, what does digital engineering mean for you, and why would it be of any benefit?
Well, look, it is a critical lever for us. I represent, I suppose, the construction end of this conversation. Digital absolutely has to be part of how we go to work, and increasingly it has to transform how we work. We're an industry that has some metrics that no one can be comfortable with, productivity being one of them. You know, we are in the slow lane in terms of productivity, and that's a global industry statement. 1% year on year for the last 20 years compared to global productivity growth of 2.8 or 3. So there's work to do across the industry globally. Digital has to be part of how we address some of that productivity underperformance. But I think, you know, Simon's touched on a few other things. You know, we have a diversity dilemma. We have some safety records that, again, none of us can be comfortable with. And the sooner we, and the further we go down a digitally activated way of working, the sooner we can really tangibly address some of those things that really need addressing.
Excellent. And Ian, from your view, when you look at the opportunities that exist in a broader digital context with a digitally engineered built environment, what are they?
Thanks, Adam. I think we're at a relatively still early stage in terms of our embracing of digital. My background's actually telecoms, mobile communications in particular. And that's a sector where there's very little actually physical built. All the value, all the services are created in the digital world, which means you can change and adapt really, really quickly. And one of the things we learned fairly early on as we moved from GSM to 3G and so on is that the physics wasn't good enough anymore. We'd actually deploy a network, suck all the data in, optimize, push it back out, and then just repeat that process. And that was a real eye-opener, that very little of the value creation was actually in the physical world. Most of it was data. When you look across different sectors, building and construction looks to be at the other end of that spectrum. Most of the value you think is created in the physical realization of the physical objects and the physical buildings. But the practical reality is that there's so much more we could do in the world of data and digital. And I'm literally just back from an IEC general meeting in San Francisco, and we're talking about the disruption everywhere, in every sector, about digital. and how we as the world of standards need to think differently about it, and that is true for everything. So far we've touched on digital twins, we haven't talked about Internet of Things, we haven't talked much about AI, we haven't talked much about data sharing and use, we have talked a little bit about metadata. There is an ocean of stuff coming. You have not seen anything yet. So I think that those that don't embrace digital are genuinely going to be left in the 20th century, which is the past. Those that don't embrace digital and the digital services are not going to be competitive. And issues like diversity and inclusion, or even cybersecurity and privacy, are aspects you can't solve with a simple model. It's something you have to think holistically about and from a whole of ecosystem, whole of an economy perspective about. And if you don't think it's happening, just wait a moment and you will see wave after wave after wave of digital innovation come barreling towards you.
Wow. James, how are you responding? If you agree with Ian, and I think it's pretty hard not to, how are you responding today on the ground to those types of challenges?
Oh, look, I mean, Ian probably has a different view of what's ahead of us, but I've got no doubt tomorrow is going to be fundamentally different to today, and next week and next month and next year will be even more radically different. So we know we can't stay here. We know we can't keep practicing the way we have. Quite what that looks like in individual businesses is really at the hands of, you know, business leadership. But at an industry and sort of government level or jurisdictional level, there are some things that we can and should be doing to get better ready for that, such as having the open conversation around what is a sensible and rational architecture or definition for the data that we generate each and every day. You know, we need to get more organised around that. No single participant around this conversation can solve it themselves. It requires joined up thinking. Again, just thinking about the industry I'm part of, you know, historically we've had fairly adversarial forms of contract that sort of push parties to either corner of the room. We need to examine whether that's the right environment to really move the industry forward. If I look at government across our country, you know, we're a federation of states, and each of our state leaders have differing views and wants and direction. And I think it's important we look at a national level. Where can we get uniformity in some of what we're trying to do here? Because, you know, I suspect many around this forum have a part of businesses that operate across borders. So you want some way of working that translates from New South Wales to South Australia to WA to Tasmania. And at the moment, we're a little bit hamstrung by some of those jurisdictional differences. So I think it's a really important debate that we're having, how we can get harmonisation in the data that we are increasingly going to generate in much greater volumes than we are today. Does that answer your question?
It does, it does. And it leads to a question to Simon. So in the paper, Simon, that we put out, we put some mapping in there that looked at media and entertainment, financial, manufacturing, and the software sectors, and then the construction sector. And to my really simple eye, it showed that there was a delta between where everybody else is on the data journey and the connectivity journey, and then the construction sector. Was that a fair interpretation from me?
Yeah, I'd sort of interpret the same. If you guys haven't seen it, bit of a plug. Check out the paper, available online. But yeah, so in the, I took an extract from research paper from 2014 from a company called Box, which is like Dropbox. And they did these sort of knowledge graphs of five different industries. And it's quite fascinating because it just shows the pattern of the way these different industries work. So financial services, heavily centralized. There's like one big node. It's like a galaxy, you know, everything's all coming into a central point. Manufacturing and software, a lot of collaboration, but in the construction sector, it's this thin, wispy shadow compared to the others. Very dislocated, very low levels of collaboration. It really is the outlier, and you just look at it, it just stands out like a sore thumb. And you know, it's endemic of our sector where, to you know, James's point, Australia is an island. Each jurisdiction in some ways is like an island. But if you go inside each jurisdiction, I was working in health, sorry, in transport, but in health and education and justice, they're all dislocated as well. It's just like another island. Projects, you know, government agencies, jurisdictions, all broken up. And somewhere in the middle, we're trying to manage data in this heavily fragmented nation. And so if we start thinking around some form of collaboration where, just imagine if we could start bridging those gaps, because now we all have not just common ways of describing files or, you know, basic deliverables, but actually we have an underlying common data model. We can just use things in databases. We can query data en masse. Am I getting value on this project versus many other projects? How are other states going? How are other sectors going? We could ask all sorts of, get all sorts of insights that we can never have, because at the moment we're this sort of thin, wispy, dislocated sector.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to open up to questions from the floor here in a second, but I've got a question first for Ian. So, Ian, in terms of a construction sector conversation, what is a smart city, and what role should the construction sector have in that smart city?
It's a great question. So I sit for New South Wales government. I chair the Smart Cities Advisory Council, and we had a presentation from Standards Australia recently talking about the recently released paper on smart city standards. From the perspective I sit in, from a government perspective, it's about delivering services to the customers of New South Wales and being able to adapt those services to the needs of people as they adapt. From a technological perspective, it's about gathering data, using data to help situational awareness, to understand root cause when things go wrong, to understand how to optimise things in a meaningful way, as we were starting to build from during COVID, understanding what was happening to New South Wales as we applied restrictions. From a construction perspective, it's actually about making sure the infrastructure is in place, thinking ahead about all the different forms of data that we need to gather or will gather, whether it's deliberate purposed sensors or whether it's things like secondary use of information and secondary sources, and then the ability to do something about it. With the New South Wales Government Smart Cities, Smart Places Advisory Committee, all the things we talk about actually come back to data and the ability to capture it, to store it, to use it in an appropriate, safe, ethical ways, which are also in line with what we've agreed with the customer data charter. This is what we will do with your data. This is what we won't do with your data. So there's a lot of simple digital plumbing issues from a construction perspective. There is a whole lot of alignment issues between different layers of government, between different parties. And someone, I think it might have been Simon earlier, said this isn't something that anyone in particular has got. It's something that whenever we do a smart places, smart cities activity, we need to have industry. We need to have at least two layers, preferably three layers of government. We need to have the innovation sector. We need to have stakeholders. We need to have customers. We need to have citizens. We need to have people who are talking about diversity and inclusion. And we need that safe space to think through some of these big problems that don't drive people into different corners. So there's a lot to that question, Adam. But hopefully the most important messages are being ready, being able to identify where the smart needs to go, and then being able to appropriately and safely share and use data to make things smart and responsive.
Excellent. And that's really the basis of the conversation that we want to have over the next few months, about being ready. And I think we've described it as a pivot in terms of our thinking, to sort of pause, reflect on all the good that's going on at the moment, and then what we can do perhaps a little bit differently. There's a question here. It's a little bit beyond me, so I'll flick it to you, Simon. Does the COBE address the data challenges like we've seen in asset management software?
Just for the non-COBE fanboys out there. Get COBE, Construction Operations Building Information Exchange. Essentially, a basic data model for transferring data from one stage to the next. And it was set up to extract metadata from outside the BIM model. So BIM becomes a primary way of managing metadata, and we take metadata out of the BIM model and put it in a spreadsheet. Now that was set up many years ago, but the data model is really quite basic in many ways. It was only set up for buildings, and there was a paper done many years ago, back in 2013, I think, around Kobe for All, whether or not that's going to solve, how this could be used for many other types of industries. It's not appropriate for what we need these days. Back when Kobe was invented, people were using Nokia 3210s. The world has moved on. Nobody wants to use a Nokia 3210 anymore, and I don't think things like Kobe are necessarily ideal solutions for what we need going forward.
Excellent.
Another question here from Eric Bajiga online. The transition to an open data-centric industry requires agreement between many parties to start instigating the transition. I think that's very fair. The next question that I'm going to throw to each of you, who should facilitate the journey, and how do we avoid the interest or the sort of challenge of self-interest and gain versus what's best for the industry? So Ian, I might start with you as the person furthest from the construction sector, and then come back to James and then Simon.
Sure, thank you. So it's a really important question, because this emerges again and again in different sectors. Recently, we tried to do some work in circular economy and came unstuck because we couldn't get data from different providers. We had, during the fires in New South Wales, we tried to access data from different commercial mobile phone operators and came unstuck because there was a real sensitivity about sharing coverage. And you can pick example after example after example. And part of the answer has to be that we need to create that safe space. So that's really very important. No one's going to get into trouble. No one will be commercially disadvantaged by sharing data. There are some technological ways that we can address that. Sometimes we don't need to see the data. I don't need to see that A equals 1 in your data set. I just need to know whether A is greater than B, or A is equal to B, or A is less than B. And sometimes that's enough. And so being able to change what we mean by sharing, I think, is really quite important, and using data. But there's always concern about consequences of what happens. If you know that A equals B, then you could do something in terms of commercially disadvantaging me, and so on. So being really clear about what we can and can't do with the insights we generate from data, or the data products we generate, is really quite important. New South Wales is about to create a connectivity index across all of New South Wales, which says, this is the mobile phone coverage I've got, these are the other sorts of coverage I've got, this is how reliable it is, this is whether it's real time or not, and this is the number of alternative sources I've got. That's really, really powerful if we can do it. And so we're going to work through that safe space idea to try and create that index for all of New South Wales, and then set aspirational targets. And the difference between the two is the market creating opportunity. Everyone wants that market creating opportunity. No one really wants to share their data. So we're working through that exact idea right now to see whether or not we could engage in an environment where people don't give up commercial advantage, don't disadvantage themselves, don't put themselves up for unnecessary harms. And part of the answer is thinking differently about how we actually share the data.
Excellent. James.
Yeah, to some extent it's a bit like, the 11 secret herbs and spices. We all derive value from the data that we generate in particular and probably unique ways. I think sooner we can get to some consistency in that, then the better we'll all perform. That sounds very aspirational or democratised. At the end of the day, we have an economy full of businesses that go head-to-head in competition. That's going to remain. But I think the role here sits with a somewhat impartial body, and that's where I think this conversation led by Standards Australia is hugely valuable. There are other cross-jurisdictional agencies that can play a leading role, but then who and where and how individual businesses derive value from a consistent pool of data that we're generating, that becomes the competitive advantage. But there is a role for agencies outside of individual enterprises to really take a lead here.
Excellent. Simon.
Right, okay. So the question being, I'll look at, because the question's just put up the screen, but the part which I'll tackle is, how does this become, or how do we stop, you know, different organizations just trying to, I guess, take ownership or use a commercial advantage to dominate? I look at this as a bit like in construction. We'll talk about design, build, and then you get a thing at the end. So, you know, if we just sort of talk generally, architects tend to work in design space, engineers tend to work in the construction or the build space, and at the end you get a new building or a railway or whatever. In sort of business change, but also in data specifically, we have architects and engineers as well. Data architects who will work on a conceptual data model. Then you have your engineers, your data engineers, who will work on the logical and physical data models. They work out how to build the database, how to operate it. And I think, you know, we know, architects and engineers, we know how to build physical things, but there's all these other architects and engineers that we need to bring into our space who come from data management. And I think where I want to try to explore things is that data management is a discipline in its own right. I mentioned Dharma International earlier. And I think those are the kind of things that are going to help us to democratize the, the expertise around what good data management looks like. So maybe that's a thing we can explore over the next few months.
Excellent. Now, questions from the room here. We've got some roving mics. If you wouldn't mind, John, just introducing yourself for the people online when the mic comes.
Hi, it's John Leiby. I represent Master Builders Association on Kapla Standard. I can see in New South Wales in the last 2 years, 3 years, we have come a long way by establishing a building portal, you know, to do with Class 2. And that kind of tie up a lot of work with design and design practitioner and the Design Practitioner Act. Firstly, we could see that could be a good platform for the building industry to expand across the board, and that kind of tie up a lot of building information together. And I could see as well from the standard point of view, and I mean, last year we have come a long way as well, that we introduced access to standard, all standard under the National Construction Code for the price of a cup of coffee for small businesses, which is a great achievement. So could we see something like that building portal be expanding across the board in the construction industry and tying all the information together with standard, with National Construction Code, and all the government agency like with council and like land title, which is already digital.
Sorry,
thank you.
When you say Class 2, you mean Class 2 residential construction?
Correct.
As part of the Building Commissioner's work?
Yes, the Design Practitioner Act, and if that goes across the board, it's going to be a great initiative for the building and construction industry as far as information and transformation to digital, which is any foreman on site can access everything on his mobile phone or computer, and all that data safely saved. Like, we come a long way with MyGov, and that we got MyGov, we've gone that for about a year, and how much information that captured in New South Wales or across the country. So if we, something at that base, it could be great achievement for the building industry. Thank you.
I'm going to take that, or do you want to? I'll jump in. I'll start it. It's a great question, so thank you. The building portal is definitely a window of things to come. It's a sign of, we want to have more online platforms for being able to manage data en masse. To be able to query data. The one thing I'd say with that portal, though, it's more work could be done for the upfront design of the data. So, at the moment, there's a lot more capability that we could inject by designing what entities, what libraries of attributes, what ways we can query data to have all sorts of dashboarding sitting on top. But it's a definite, it's all progress, and I think it's a brilliant start to where New South Wales government should be going.
And I might answer, John, from Standards Australia's perspective. So this is an uncomfortable conversation for us in one sense. Not your question at all, but this digital engineering conversation is a little bit uncomfortable because for 100 years we've developed our standards in a particular way. The level of metadata, and our team is working really hard at the moment to enrich that metadata that sits behind the content, is it's emerging. And in order to sort of operate in a digital engineering environment, you need the sort of standards and codes to all be aligned. I know, talking to James, the state and territory variations to that is challenging if you're working at sort of scale across the country, let alone the globe. So do we want to answer that question that you've posed? You know, should we have that platform? Absolutely. But we're nowhere near that conversation yet. And what we want to do over the next few months is to really work with people deeply in the construction sector and people peripheral to it to work out how this might work. And at the end of the day, people might say, you know what, nah, there's nothing to do here, everything's fine. We don't think so. We think that the more that we can have these types of conversations, the stronger the outcomes will be. Are there any more hands in the room, or will I go back to some of the online questions? Down the back.
Hi there. My name's Nick. I'm a research officer here at Standards. It was briefly mentioned before that contract relationships in the construction world tend to be particularly adversarial. One of the things you hear about blockchain technology is that it can enable smart contracts, self-executing contracts that aren't subject to a central authority. But with so many things in the blockchain world, it's hard to tell just how valuable or practical that really is. So my question for the panel was, what value do you see in those technologies? Are people in construction adopting those technologies?
Do you want to?
Yeah. Look, good question. There is no shortage of beneficial technology out there, blockchain being one of them. At the end of the day, there are humans in the room. You know, I think as much as anything, it's not a technology conversation. It's a behaviour and culture shift that we need to look at. Having made the statement, you know, our industry has had a history of sort of adversarial forms of contract. That is definitely shifting. We're seeing better forms of contract across the industry every day. So we're moving. And technology can accelerate some of that. Blockchain might be part of it. I think the last 2 years, you know, the last three, I don't want to reprise the last 3 years. None of us want to go back there, but that has kind of forced us to examine some ways of working, and we need to take the good bits out of what we've all experienced over the last 3 years in terms of ways of working and agility and so on, and move forward with the good bits of that stuff. So, yeah.
Ian.
So I didn't mention blockchain. I wasn't going to be the first person to mention blockchain. But since you brought it up, the smart contracts part is probably poorly named, because ultimately all you ever really do is confirm a little transaction as opposed to getting a lawyer to say yes or someone to agree or disagree. But blockchain is actually being used right at the moment. Some of you will have heard about the New South Wales Building Commissioner has instigated a blockchain system to underpin the supply of all the components in a building, ultimately to build a trust index. When Grenfell Tower happened in the UK, the team that I was running with in New South Wales government was given the task of trying to identify buildings at risk of flammable aluminium, non-compliant aluminium cladding was the term that we used. And we used all sorts of data sets to try and identify buildings, but ultimately fire and rescue went out there and tested every single building that we identified. And our hit rate was okay. It wasn't great, but it was okay, because the data sets we had were actually not that good and not that reliant. And we were really imaginative about the data sets we used. Partly, we couldn't source beyond where materials landed in Australia. We couldn't source back to the origin. The intention is now to actually source things right back to the origin and follow every single component that goes to a building. So in instances like that, blockchain is quite useful. Work's been done by KPMG, and when I said you ain't seen nothing yet, when you realise what you can do when you start to digitise all the components of a building and all the provenance and connect them to all the suppliers, you suddenly create this incredible ecosystem where you've got much, much more data than you ever thought you could possibly have, and you've got much, much more ability to do things with that data than you would have thought previously. And throw some AI and connect that to another system and connect it to another system, all of a sudden you realize that you are really at the edge of an incredible data series of oceans, and you can start to do some pretty amazing stuff around how you would manage and control buildings, how you'd manage and control cost, how you manage and control interaction with those buildings. And the point that I mentioned earlier about cybersecurity and privacy, a smart building or a smart city or a smart environment uses a lot of data about people. And if you've got a GDPR type restriction on use of that data, a simple model just doesn't cut it when you think about this little bit of data intersecting with that little bit of data in this context, in that place. So all of a sudden, these incredible possibilities open up when you start to digitize, and that building commissioner's experiment with blockchain starts to really pull some really powerful threads, which opens up a whole new world of opportunities.
And that really takes us back to this question about, well, it's not an iterative change that we're talking about here. It's a system change. So all the good work that goes on downstream in different elements of the construction sector today needs to be sort of rolled up into a bigger question. And then, Ian, I assume that there are other sectors that deal with people's personal information and deal with data at scale, and we might be able to rely on some of the protocols that already exist, or do we have to invent some new ones?
You're just saying that to make me happy, Adam. So I spent a lot of late nights working with the world of JTC1's SC32, specifically Working Group 6, looking at data usage. We're looking to release a standard about all data usage of all kinds, and the considerations for use, what you need to understand about data to use it for the purpose you're about to use it for, and the guidance restrictions, prohibitions you put on data products. We'll have it middle of next year, fingers crossed we'll have it middle of next year. But it also ties in with a whole lot of standards which are coming down about metadata. And again, that's from the world of SC32, JTC1, SC32, Working Group 2, are putting out a whole stack of new metadata standards. And ultimately, it's metadata that matters about the data. All data sets are incomplete, all data sets are imperfect, all data sets are less than 100% quality. But if you know how it got to you, if you can assess its fitness for purpose, and you can build the structures around it for appropriate further use of data and data products, you're off to a you're in a much better position for actually dealing with the digital part of what we're talking about.
Excellent. Last call for questions in the room, if there are any burning hands. There's a burning hand over here.
Thanks, Rory. Ryan from New South Wales Government, and it's great to see some familiar faces. I had a question on the concept or on sort of the national agenda. If I can be, so forthright, I think New South Wales Government's doing some great things. I absolutely know some of the other states are doing some wonderful things as well. What's the way that we can, though, make sure that we join this up? So that we get the best value, the best buying for the whole of the country.
I'm going to fail the one, so yeah, good to see you, Rory. It is a really challenging question, but what I'd say is when you're trying to make change, like in my experience when I was trying to make change when I was in New South Wales government myself, I found that you could put most people that you're trying to influence in one or two camps. Either they're technical, but they're not very influential. They're also influential, but maybe not very technical. And if you can try to find both, happy days, because then you can do great things. But you are trying to influence both camps and trying to communicate on both levels to make that change happen. I think we are going to have to build the right narrative that starts landing, or really connecting with both influential and technical people. If the message is just influential, but it's fluff, it doesn't go anywhere. If it's technical, but not compelling, it's great. You can be the smartest person in the room, but you never make change because you can't influence anyone. So we need the right narrative that really cuts across both technical and influential. I'll be happy to road test it on you.
James, do you have a perspective on that question as well?
Yeah, I think there are some good current examples where government, particularly at state level, are collaborating, sharing best practice from their various agencies, or I'll call out the Construction Industry Leadership Forum as an example. You know, some really good joined up thinking from industry and state government across various jurisdictions across the country. So I think we can create the environment and the forums to have knowledge sharing conversations and learn from each other. I'm firmly of a view none of us can crack it alone. It requires collective thinking to move this forward. And Simon made the point, you know, we did this with safety. We know we can do it. We know we can, you know, some of this is about sort of democratising the knowledge and setting it free and seeing how far we can move the industry forward. So there are examples, there are reference points out there. I think we just need to go again.
Excellent. Excellent. So we've got 54 seconds left on our live stream. And there's two questions that we didn't get to that came in online. One was about sort of how do we value data? And then the second question was what sort of incentives can we find from governments to help the industry move along this journey, which are really good segues into how we wanted to close out this discussion today. So we have given you no answers today around digital engineering. That was never the purpose. The purpose of today was to bring the leaders together in person and online to socialise a concept about what it is that we might want to do next. And we've got a plan over the next 3 months to really do three things. So to look at what other sectors have done to crack some of these nuts, to look at what's happening around the world with others in the engineering sector, and then to look at how we can bring in all the really good work that's going on in some of the ISO committees around BIM and some of the JTC1 committees that are going on at the moment, and bring it all together through a process of convergence and to do it with all of you. So thank you all for joining us today. For those of you online, enjoy your afternoons, evenings and mornings. For those of you in the room here, we'd love to stay and have a chat. And Standards Australia very much looks forward to hosting this conversation over the next few months. Thank you all.
Snow White, she did right, and her life had seven men to do the job.